You're listening to FromeFM. This is Soundcheck. My name is Sarah Vianne.
And I'm Dave Clark.
And tonight we have got Craig Fortnam from Arch Garrison. Hello. Hello, Craig.
Hello.
And you're going to be appearing at the Granary on Saturday, July the 9th, during the Frome Festival, aren't you?
Yes, I am.
So very welcome to Frome.
And thank you.
Let's kick off with your first song.
Right on.
Thank you.
Sometimes I wish I'd stayed on the land, digging up bones, lending a hand, cause I'm failing at trying and making it play. A song is a mirror, I'll put it away. Sometimes it's nothing at all, moving the air in a room or a hall. I'm failing at trying and making it play. A song is a mirror, I'll put it.
Cheers, Craig. Thanks very much for that. That's everything all. It seems to speak about what it's like to go out there, do music for people, play in rooms. How sometimes it's great, it's the best thing ever. Sometimes it feels like a bit of a struggle.
About, you know, it's a, I sort of realise as the older I get, which is quite old now, that everything seems to be a double-edged sword in life. Nothing's for free, you know, and I think with amazing things comes sort of some tragedy maybe and vice versa. I just think there's everything's kind of a double-edged sword I've discovered, and being doing music's certainly that, you know, and so sometimes it's just nothing at all. It means kind of, it doesn't, sometimes it doesn't mean as much as it maybe could, but then sometimes it's too important, you know.
So whereabouts are you at the moment with the music? Is it feeling like everything all, or is it?
No, it's good at the moment, because I've got a new album under the belt. So, so my other project, you know, North Sea Radio Orchestra. So that I've just finished our fourth record of that. So, and that's done. It's in the can. It's mastered. It's finished. It's out in September.
Oh, really?
In September. So, so I'm feeling quite. I've listened to it to death. I tend to listen to it to death, and then just before it comes out, I never listen to it again. You know, ever. And I've listened to it a lot, and I still like it, so that's pretty good. So I'm, you know, I'm reasonably happy.
I'm excited about that.
Did you produce it yourself?
Again, another double-edged sword is that it's great to have all that control, but it does drive you a bit potty, sort of a year and a half, you know, microscoping and getting completely anal about every part of the whole thing can drive you mad, you know. So I was quite pleased it was finished as well, you know.
But to produce anything worthwhile, you've really got to polish it and polish it and polish it.
You want stuff to it's got to be right. You got to. I can. There's things I leave things in that aren't necessarily right, but I couldn't leave anything I couldn't live with, you know.
Yeah.
I like to leave certain things in because there is so much control. It's nice to kind of subvert, you know. There's more improvising on this album and stuff like that. So there's much more improvising, which I've left bits in and then edited. It's just there's more elements of chance, which is nice, you know. Because otherwise it's complete, you know, control freakery.
So with the new album, I know you're going to be doing Arch Garrison next week for us, and that's what you're here to play now tonight. But always very excited about a new North Sea Radio Orchestra thing. Have you stuck with the same sort of formula in terms of words and music, or is it purely instrumental? Is Sharon doing any singing on it?
No, there is some singing. There's about, I think she sings on four songs. It's the usual mixture of instrumentals and songs, and we've always done that.
And
there's about four songs. There's a Robert Wyatt cover on there, which is good. Yeah,
which
a song called
done?
British Road. Do you know that?
No.
I think it's on Old Rotten Hat.
Oh, yeah.
Because we did a show in France doing Robert Wyatt music for a festival in Lyon, and I did all these arrangements of Robert Wyatt, and one of my favourites was this song, The British Road, so I just really wanted it to be on the album, you know. So I sent Robert Wyatt an email, got a nice reply.
Lovely.
Yeah, he likes it, so that's great, you know.
Grand.
Yeah.
So that's North Sea, but we're here about Arch Garrison, you're going to be playing on Saturday night at the Granary. You'll have with you James Larkham.
He plays. We've got this old sort of filicorda organ. Like an old 60s organ, which is great, and also a bit of mono synth, so some sort of analog synth and organ kind of accompaniment to these songs.
Yeah.
So there's a few bits where I'm ooing and ahhing today, which normally there's like keyboard, you know, nice organs playing.
Yeah, mouthing the keyboard parts.
So it's great when he plays it as well. Looking forward to it.
Well, so are we. It's going to be quite an honour to be in the same room
and do
a bit of warm-up.
Should I say that your band's going to be supporting it at this point?
I think we should. Dexter's Extra Breakfast is going to be there, trying to get the room warm for you.
Well, it's all right, we'll cool it down again, don't worry.
grand. It'd be nice to have another
tune. Song,
What we're going to get next?
So I'll play The Oldest Road, shall I?
Yeah.
So that one, shall I just briefly say what that's
about?
I've since moving to Wiltshire from London, 10 years ago now, blimey, 10 years this summer, I got sort of very into all the old tracks and roads and getting the Ordnance Survey map out and going out with a dog and going exploring and kind of really fired my imagination, the kind of ancient landscape and the fact that all these little tracks were quite major thoroughfares at one point. And I don't know, it sort of does something to my brain. I don't know. So a lot of that album, I'd Be a Pilgrim, is about walking the chalk, you know, the downs and really getting, that's really kind of where I'm from anyway. I was sort of grew up near Oxford on the Downs and sort of it's kind of in my blood, I think, a bit. So the whole album is, a lot of the album is concerned with that. And the Oldest Road is, I walked a lot of the Ridgeway one summer, and and that kind of, the song The Oldest Road is kind of about the Ridgeway, but it's about just walking and being up on top, out away from everything, and I don't know, but sort of feeling very connected to the ancientness of it all. And
And the many generations of feet that have walked that same way.
That sort of thing, I really get into that. But I really get into things that are spotting in the landscape, things that aren't apparent, but when you look at a map or something, you can see things that, I don't know, I could have been a landscape archaeologist, I think, in another world, you know, in another life. Quite like all that sort of thing. Bit of a nerd.
Well, you made reference in the last song to wishing I'd stayed on the land, digging up bones.
Well, I wanted to be an archaeologist when I was a kid.
Is that right?
And then I got the bloody music. You know, this is why I'm a slight ambivalent thing about music, because it's not a simple life being a musician, is it? Whereas if I'd been an archaeologist, maybe I would have just sort of gone and done my job, and then when I went home, I wasn't doing my job anymore. Whereas with music, it tends to be all the time. Which is, has its brings its own pressures, you know. So it's kind of almost like a hankering, that song, to sort of put it all aside and just sort of do something else. Not that I'm gonna, you know.
No.
But you know, there's a small part of me that thinks, I wonder what it'd be like if I'd just been an archaeologist. You know?
Yeah.
I don't know. Not that I'm moaning about it. I haven't got a gun to my head saying be a musician, you know. I did choose it.
I love Time Team.
Time Team.
Yeah.
Are they real archaeologists?
They are, yeah.
Of course they are.
I didn't know if there was archaeology snobbery or anything.
No. I might have watched a few Time Teams in my time.
I don't think I've watched any.
Most of them.
Oh my God, you'll love it. They're all in rainbow jumpers, earrings. They're real rebels. They go out for a beer after they've dug the land. You'll love it.
I'm sure. Yeah, just haven't got time to watch telly, really.
Got time. Right, shall I crack on then?
Yes, please. Right, so this is The Oldest Road.
Yep.
There with sight and sound, do we maximise the all is wrong. Never more, no.
Can I just say it reminds me of White Chalk by PJ Harvey a little bit.
Right.
Do you know that one?
I don't know that, no.
Check it
out. I know she's sung about all that stuff, hasn't she? Maybe she's got similar concerns.
Devon landscape, sort of.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Devon Chalk, I don't know, it might be. Devon that goes in a big zigzag.
She's from Bridport, isn't she?
Is she? That's Dorset.
Yeah. Oh, sorry, Dorset.
Yeah, that is Chalk there, yeah. So she's obviously got... Because when I was a kid and I lived in a little village... Right near the Ridgeway, near Didcot in Oxfordshire, yeah. And everywhere you went when you were a kid out playing with your mates, all the footpaths are all white, you know, you see this chalk, and I don't know, it sort of goes into your brain, I think, if you grow up on that stuff. It does run into mine anyway. Yeah. There's something about that landscape that's very magnetic or something, you know. I don't know.
Well, the fact that the chalk is, it's deposited, it's the deposits of all the stuff that was alive in the sea many millions of years ago. And the fact that we're walking
on it now. It's the oldest inhabited part of England, isn't it? People came over when there was still before the Channel, when that was still a land bridge, and they came and they walked down the Ridgeway, you know, across that ridge down and into kind of Wiltshire and, you know, Hampshire and all that sort of thing. It's quite interesting, you know.
I love it. I love the fact that you put in. Did you rhyme fluvial with alluvial?
Yeah, I did.
That?
Yeah.
I love that.
Yeah, I was quite pleased with that.
There can't be another song in the world that's got that rhyme in it.
Fluvial alluvial. Yeah, can't believe it hasn't been done before.
It was crying out to be done. Yeah, no, it's a gorgeous tune. And for me, that was like, off the last album, that was, if there was going to be a hit tune from that,
it's
was
kind of like the most, sort of straight ahead song, isn't it, in a way?
Yeah. Yeah,
really, I do have really proggy close. Tendencies, you know, as you know.
So. Yeah, oh, absolutely, yeah.
So that's quite straight ahead. That
one. Yes, yeah.
I like the odd funny chord and things like that.
Yeah. And it's because where you've got to now, I mean, you've been in the music for a few years now, and we're very much part of the around the Cardiacs when they were on the go, and all the little things.
There's
that
lots of bands
shot off from there.
Yeah.
It's like been an explosion almost from that centre, and it seems like where you've got to now, because, you know, I was just looking at a few old Cardiacs videos before I came over, you know, Tarred and Feathered and Stitch in Time, and, you know, it's pretty manic. It's kind of grotesque. It's quite violent in lots of ways.
Well, but that's also extremely beautiful, though. I mean, I've chosen a Cardiacs song as one of my songs to play, sort of.
Yeah.
And it's a more of the sort of, it's a slower, more beautiful, more overtly beautiful.
Yeah.
I always found them really, really beautiful, even when they were being really up-tempo, shall we say, because of the chords and the melodies are just very beautiful, I think, even when Tim's shouting them or screaming them or whatever, you know.
But what I mean, for me, what comes across very strongly is this enjoyment of the grotesque, you know, the really putting it in your face.
Yeah.
And being very quite challenging with the structures and the delivery, and you know, you were in and around all that, and then it feels like where you've got to now is into a kind of quieter place. You know, it's nylon string, it's not much decoration, it's not a lot of anything apart from the voice and the guitar going.
Yeah, the Arch Garrison thing, definitely.
Yeah.
I mean, it's doing the North Sea Radio Orchestra. That's quite there's a lot of work in all. It's very arranged. There's loads going on, and it's I've always had. Wanted to write little songs as well, and so I just—it's just a way of me satisfying that, you know. And it's easier. Me and James can go out and do gigs much easier, you know. It's just—it's nice to do something that's simple and or easier, you know, as well as the more grander thing, you know.
Yeah.
So, what album are you playing these songs from today?
These so far from the "I Will Be a Pilgrim," which was came out in 2014, the Arch Garrison album, which I wrote down in Salisbury.
And then there was the previous one of that was King of a Down. Which again, is that King of a Down as in reference
Down,
to
it's still
Down the Chalk Uplands?
Basically got a one-track mind. because we moved... it's funny, because when we moved to Wiltshire, I felt a bit like I was moving back to where I was from, because it's very similar landscapes, Chalk Downs and all that stuff. And And but on that first album, I was very aware that I still felt really attached to London. Mm-hmm. And I still sort of do in a way, but less so because I haven't lived there for 10 years. But I felt really connected to two very different places, and that I thought that was quite... Mm-hmm. I don't know, there's a few songs about that on that album, and it's, yeah, it's about sort
about
of...
commuting.
Yeah, no, I wasn't... Yeah. About the at 6:45 in the morning. Yeah. So it's often about connecting with the place, you know. I quite like to get maps out when I move to somewhere and get to know the area and connect with it, you know.
And you're very much settling down in south of Salisbury, living the life there with the family. Music and helping to manage some of the legacy of Tim Smith.
One of the reasons we moved to Wiltshire was that we knew people down there, Tim and Susie being some friends, and Matthew as well, some friends who were all Cardiacs people. They sort of ended up down near Salisbury, and, and it was handy for that. It's the right side of London and all that stuff. So we ended up moving there, And then when Tim got ill, we were in the area. So we've been, over the past sort of what's been quite a long time now, 8 years or something. Less so now because we've got family now and stuff. We just have less time. But when it, when Tim first got ill, we were quite involved in trying to help him out and stuff, you know.
How's
other people
have
rallied around to... keep his house, sort his house out of stuff, you know. Bick Hayes used to be in Cardiacs, he did a load of, him and Joe did a load of work on the house, and people have rallied round, you know, it's been very sweet.
Because it seemed like Iron Moon, which was the last North Sea Radio Orchestra album, there was a lot of the lyrics were reflected on Tim's situation and the loss of a good friend.
If you want to write a song, normally, you know, songs tend to dictate what they are by what's going on in your life, you know, personally anyway. If I want to sit down and write a song about a subject, chances are it wouldn't end up being about that. It would be about what's going on inside me at the time, you know. So that the Arch Garrison album was often about all these roads and things I used to go wandering around on. That Iron Moon album, Tim was ill when I was writing it, you know, that's it was all in the middle of it all. So a lot of the songs, I sat down to write a song and it ended up being about that situation because it was a big deal at the time, you know. It was quite a major event, you know.
So how's he doing at the moment?
Is
he?
He's okay. He's fine. You know, he's still he can't perform or anything. Still, he's physically at a place where he needs some intervention, I think. You know. But, but you know, he's great. He's still, you know, he can still take the mic, and you know, he has a laugh, and you know, he's okay.
Good. We'll have another song in a minute. One of the things that you do as a support is these ABC conventions.
Is there
one this year? Has there been a one this year?
No, we need to. We possibly could have done one this year, but I think we'll have to try and do one next year. This is the Cardiacs convention for all the.
This
Cardiacs
is like
fans.
all the people who are still around Cardiacs.
Fans can enjoy a sort of Cardiacs night without them playing.
Bit of a shindig,
but it's good. We have related bands and we have the merchandise. And
I know. We nearly came down to last year because Knifefield were playing.
It's a really nice night. There's a lot of love in the room. It's really nice.
And so I think before we go to the sort of next section of the show, we'll have another tune.
Okay.
What we're going to have next?
Okay. This is my last song about roads. All right. This is Where the Green Lane Runs, which is the first one on the album. So this is about I was watching some documentary or telly or something. Anyway, saw all these old people in an old people's home, you know, lined up against the wall in their chairs. Looked a bit grim. Thought, you know. Why can't you just sort of, I'm just going to wander, when it's my turn to go, I'm just going to wander off like a deer, you know, and find somewhere to die, basically. Not in a morbid way, but in a kind of cool way, I don't know. So anyway, this song, in effect, is about imagining my own death. It's like the opening number on the album, you know, it's sock it to him between the eyes and sing a jolly song about what happened, you know, a way of dying, you know. Finding a little place next to a drove or something and setting up a little camp and just sort of, I don't know.
Saying it's a good day to die.
Maybe today is a good day to die.
Yes.
Yeah. So it's kind of about that, really.
Right.
Yeah, all right.
Grand. Thank you. Thank you.
rise to the setting sun and look for high ground. There I'll make a start. It might seem strange to eulogize a piece of land and where it lies between the A road and the river that flows. It might seem strange to eulogize a piece of land and where it lies, but I know where I'll go, where the green lane divides.
Do a cap notes. Yeah. Do a cap notes. I may be sometime. Cheers. Thanks for that. I think you could probably put your guitar down because what we're going to ask you to do next is to do like a Desert Islands disky thing where you get to tell us about some of your musical influences. You've picked a few tracks for us to play.
Yeah,
and you can tell us why you've chosen them, why they're important to you.
I mean, I would, if I'd sort of got it together a week earlier, I would have probably chosen different tracks. You know, you sort of choose in the spur of the moment a bit, don't you?
Yeah.
But I did want to include certain people, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, of course. So, if I've got the order right, your first choice is Only Solitaire. Jethro Tull,
of course.
So, tell us about the Tull.
And your, a bit of Tull.
What about a Tull?
Bit of Tull.
Do we love him?
I don't know why I just kind of been in a bit of a Tull phase recently, you know.
Yeah.
So I just wanted to choose one of their songs, and this one is I really love the bits of Jethro Tull I love the most are when it's just Ian Anderson the singer with his guitar singing songs. I don't like the bluesy, fluty kind of.
Do you like Wandering Aloud?
I love that song. Yeah. So those sort of bits I love. I think he's an amazing guitar player. I really think he's underrated as an acoustic guitar player. He plays with a pick, but he does such amazing fluid things. He's a really great player, I think. And I've always just loved his vibe, you know. And this song, I just think it's particularly lovely. I don't even know what it's about, but I think the guitar playing is so brilliant. It was a big deal to me when I was a teenager.
It's got some really lovely, intricate acoustic picking on it, hasn't it?
It's just great, you know. Yeah. I love his singing. I just, you know, I'm going for a bit of a Tull phase, so yeah.
There it is. Because when I played it, I thought it was probably Martin Barr.
Normally he plays like the nylon when they do acoustic things. All that steel string stuff is normally Ian Anderson.
Oh, really?
Martin Barr does a bit of nylon and the electric stuff. I'm pretty sure it's all. I'm sure they're both playing on it, but the main guitar
is Ian Anderson.
He's just an amazing player. Nobody really mentions it, you know.
Yeah.
Well, maybe they do, I don't know.
Yeah. So you've chosen this because it's because of the guitar work.
I loved it when I was younger. I still, you know, I love it.
War Child.
And I just thought, War Child, not one of their most sort of slightly sniffed at.
When was it out?
I think it was 1974 or something. So
right
after the kind of Passion Play proggy stuff. I think it's after it's same sessions maybe, but more songs. It's not their best album, I don't think, but I loved it. You know, when sometimes it's the first album you get into a band and it might not be their best, but you love it because it's the first time you. I think it was the first Jethro Tull album I got. So
all right, so I've made an impression.
But the guitar playing is a big deal. I love it.
Well, I think we've
a short little song.
Have we got that queued up, Phil? Should we ever listen to it?
Oh yeah.
And that's it.
Yeah, I don't know what it's about. Really, I think it might be about critics or something. I don't know. He's quite good at. He quite likes to have a pop at people.
Seems to be a bit about, you know, what's it like to lead a band, you know, and being the man up front, and you know,
maybe.
Perhaps he's, you know, because he's the focal point, it was his band, wasn't he? You know, yeah. Like if it was going to get anything in terms of
guitar
criticism.
Is just,
I know, it's gorgeous, isn't
beautiful.
It? Yeah. Mm. Yeah, and sitting in the room with you, watching you play, is a treat. I mean,
Thank you.
The finger work
is... all those classical guitar lessons I had when I was a kid, you see.
Is that where it started?
Yeah. So I did classical guitar. That's why I play nylon and I use nails and things. That's why. And I really enjoyed it because I teach guitar quite a lot. And a lot of boys, they do some classical and then they get into rock and then they leave. But I just still love... I just did classical all the way through, you know. But we did a lot of John Dowland and stuff. I really like playing that kind of Renaissance kind of lute music that's transcribed for guitar.
Yeah.
And a lot of the chords in that are very cardiac-y sort of... very similar chords to what Tim does, these sort of Renaissance chords, sort of going to the wrong chord slightly, you know, going to an unexpected major chord.
Yeah.
Tim does that a lot in his music. And I loved all that from when I was like sort of 10 playing John Dowland and stuff. So when I heard Cardiacs, I thought, God, that sounds like John Dowland.
I understand that.
You know, yeah, it's funny. It's interesting how all these things
yeah.
you know, you tie in and then you realise that all these other people are into the same thing. It's very interesting. You know.
Because it's funny you should say that, because John Dowland is when?
I don't know. Sort of Elizabeth the First,
early,
you know,
music.
Sort of.
Right.
Yeah.
Now, when you hear something like a Cardiacs tune, it's jumping all over the place. You know, you'll suddenly get you got shifted into another key. You weren't expecting it. It's not something you associate with music of an earlier era where you're
talking about the harmony, really, the chords. You know,
the
chords.
Yeah, the chords.
Yeah, going from a to get a bit technical, to go from a G major, you'd normally go, if you went to B, you go to a B minor, because that's
the
rule.
Yeah, it's the key.
But, you know, Dowland will go to a B major, so you get that surprise. You
it's like, we've been pulled out of that key into another key.
You know, that's the sort of thing I like. So they're all regular chords, but you put them in unusual combinations, so that you're sort of constantly being lifted, you know.
Surprised by where it's gone.
And lots of people do it, you know. I used to really like, still do, Gabriel era Genesis, you know, and they did it as well, you know.
Right.
So I heard all that stuff, you know, in bands. It's like, oh, great, you know.
Yeah. The usefulness of a classical training.
Genesis, they were one of my first big loves, you know.
Really?
When I was a kid, yeah.
We nearly did a joke about that on the breakfast show this morning. right, so...
What's next?
What we have, I think we have a bit of Hawkwind.
Oh, really? Is that next? Great.
You better believe
it. Well, they were one of my other musical obsessions. You better believe it,
When you were the young Craig Fortnam back at home in...
Kingston upon Thames at this point, So,
getting into Hawkwind.
Yeah, I loved Hawkwind, yeah.
Hair down to there.
Yeah, all that stuff. My brother had a lab coat, you know, and all that. Walk around with a lab coat.
Is that right?
Drive my dad insane, you know. Yeah.
Was it plastered in?
It had all sort of writing all over it and stuff, yeah. We were classic suburban hippies, you know.
Freaking out the oldies.
Yeah. But yeah, always really loved Hawkwind. And I sort of chose it also because my brother passed away last year, very sadly. And,
oh, really?
And it got me back in, because I sort of, you know, I got all his old CDs and I got all these old Hawkwind CDs. Oh.
I think it's coming in.
Okay, yeah, that
was
Hawkwind.
That was Lemmy.
Lemmy on the harpsichord. No, so anyway, I got really into Hawkwind again because I had all these Hawkwind CDs I haven't heard for years and I've just really got into them again. And we played this, better believe it, we played it at his funeral as he was carried out of the church. This was blasting out and it was quite...
Oh, wow.
A really amazing moment, really cosmic and brilliant and, And it's just sort of, you know, it's the diesel era Hawkwind, isn't it, they call it, I think, don't they? They're kind of Lemmy years, you know.
Pretty full on
head down
charged
and,
up, isn't it?
Yeah, it's brilliant. Yeah, I think that when they were on it, they were brilliant. You know, they could be a bit hit and miss, but you know,
So this is the tune that was played at your brother's funeral last year.
Yeah.
Wow. Mm. Well, we better hear it then.
Yeah.
It's faded out. That was Hawkwind.
You're listening to FromeFM 96.6. This is Soundcheck with Sarah Vian.
Oh yeah, and Dave Flatt.
And we've got Craig Fortnam from Arch Garrison in the studio. And that was one of your chosen tracks, Hawkwind.
Yeah.
What was the name of it again?
Let Me Hear a Hawkwind.
You better believe it.
Yeah.
And that was in memory of your brother.
Well, kind of, yeah, because we played it at his funeral.
And that sort of leads on. to talk about one of the tracks that is going to be on your other project's album, coming soon
this
in September.
This is an exclusive, folks.
This is exciting.
Yeah, okay. Live and direct from the FromeFM
studio. So this is a song from the next Naughty Radio Orchestra album, and it's called Alsace-Lorraine, which was its working title, which I kept anyway because, I don't know, it evokes things in my brain, I don't know. Right. But the song is, it started off as a lullaby for my young son, Sam, but then my brother passed away kind of in the middle of writing the song, so the lyrics kind of veered into the realm of sort of grief and dealing with grief and stuff. But but it was interesting because my boy physically reminds me of my brother, when me and my brother are little lad, you know, little boys, and so sometimes I look at Sam and I can see my brother, and so in writing the song it was about them both, you know. There's kind of all these layers that I don't even understand really in the song, you know, it's about feeling, isn't it? Yeah, it's pretty emotional, I guess. You
know. What's it called? Well,
it's Alsace-Lorraine.
Okay. Yeah.
So this is a FromeFM exclusive, a track off the upcoming North Sea Radio Orchestra album, Alsace-Lorraine. Let's have it.
Bye. Okay, so that track's called Alsace-Lorraine. From
so, a bit of pop trivia, the viola player on that is the drummer in The Damned.
What, Rat Scabies?
No, not him. No, he doesn't play anymore. No,
no.
A guy called Stuffy, Stephen Gilchrist, who plays with Bill Drake's band and Graham Coxon, and he's an amazing drummer.
Yeah,
he plays viola. He played viola on that, and it turns out he's now drumming with The Damned. It's just, the world gets weirder and weirder,
It pays.
Yeah. So we got a kind of Damned crossover thing going on.
Yeah.
Probably heard it in that track.
I could hear it. The influence,
So that was a FromeFM exclusive of the North Sea Radio Orchestra's album that's going to be launched on the 9th of September.
Yes. It's released then. I don't know whether we'll be launching it then, but, you know, like a big ocean going liner down a slipway, you know.
Do you know I'm launching my album?
Really? Is that
and there's room for another act. It's a FromeFM special.
If you want to support Sarah Vianne.
No, it wouldn't be a support act. Of course not. It would be a double headline.
Double header.
Let's have this conversation on air.
I think we're all there. You could agree to it now. Why don't you?
Anyway.
Well, thanks very much for bringing that along. That's a treat. Yeah. That's an absolute treat. So this is the section where we talk a bit about influence and you brought in some music. And the next track I think we've got is the Cardiacs track.
Right, okay.
The Safety Ball.
So I should explain, I guess, for people who don't know who the Cardiacs are, that they started in 77 in Kingston-upon-Thames.
Yeah.
And they were going strong until 2007 when Tim got ill. He had a heart attack, and the main guy, the singer, Tim Smith had a heart attack and a stroke, and he's now a sort of, he can't perform these days. So they're sort of, they don't play anymore, but there's lots of stuff, there's stuff in the vaults, you know. So anyway, they were a massive influence on me. As I said earlier, you know, I was sort of listening to sort of early Genesis and playing John Dowland and things and all. And when I heard Cardiacs the first time, I seemed to sort of understand it completely and not understand it completely at the same time. It was quite amazing, really. So anyway, very big influence. And because we were in the same town, I got to know them. They became very good friends, you know. And through them I've met my wife and lots of good friends, and we're all lots of our musicians. We're in a big scene that's, as you know, centered around that.
Yeah.
So I had to choose a Cardiac song as part of one of my influences. And as you said, they can be quite punky and full on and loud and real rock and real rock and roll and everything. But I chose a song, The Safety Bowl, which is from their album On Land and in the Sea, and this is one of their more gentle, psychedelic, beautiful things. I mean, they are the best band in the world.
All right, here we go. There we have it. That's the Cardiacs. That track is called Safety Bowl from On the Land and in the Sea.
On Land and in the Sea,
And them in more mellow mode.
Yeah.
Than we sometimes think of them. So we're going to push on a bit.
Because
we're worried that that we've got a lot to fit in. So the next track you've chosen is William D. Drake.
William D. Drake. So he's the guy who's just playing keyboards on that Cardiac song, because he was their keyboard player for a long time.
Yeah.
And very good friend. And so a big moment in my life was, because I'd kind of lost contact with Bill. I'd gone to Devon and gone to Dartington and done a music degree and all that stuff, came back to Kingston, sort of lost touch with a few people, but then after a few years got back in touch with Bill, and he was doing music with Sharon, my now wife Sharon. They were doing this amazing project called Lake of Puppies. Beautiful songs that they'd written together, really amazing. And so anyway, Bill said, come and play guitar, and I went to rehearse, and I heard these songs and my jaw just dropped. I mean, it's a massive change in my life, because I thought I've been writing kind of bad contemporary classical music up until that point. And then I heard these songs and I thought, that's what I want to. I want to write beautiful things, you know, because it's so beautiful what they did. But this song is from one of Bill's albums called Briny Who's, but Sharon's singing on it. And it really is a perfect example of those two being brilliant.
Working together.
Yeah.
All right, let's hear it.
Spooky.
I forgot about the cosmic ending at the end there.
Is that one of those chords that takes you off in a surprising direction?
He's got a few of those in there,
Yeah. So that was William D. Drake, wasn't it? From his album Briny Hooves.
Yeah.
The Fountain Smoke. Beautiful, that.
So that's an old poem. I don't know who it's by, but Bill likes to set poems to music. Yeah, he does. That's where I got the idea.
That's what
from.
You were doing in the first album, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, take the old poets and set them to music.
Yeah.
Yeah. Which really worked, I thought.
Yeah.
You got a bit of stick from some critics.
Yeah, I know, because we was occasionally have a a lyric with the word thou in it or something, and you're not allowed to do that, because it means you're posh or something. That's what we used to get accused of being, like, posh and things like that. It's just like, just because we, like, have violins and you know what poems are. Do you know what I mean? It was ridiculous.
You're a rock and roll poet. You're not posh.
I mean,
no, it's really, funny, isn't it? Yeah, it's just inverted snobbery, and there's a certain amount of that around in the culture, isn't there?
Especially in the more kind of, because it's not like we're going for the club. We're not really going for the sort of classical music end of the market, the market.
Yeah, the market.
But, most people come to see us are into, indie and bands and whatever, So they're not used to hearing thee and thou in lyrics. But most people don't care, just some critics.
There's some beautiful lyrics on that first album.
Yeah.
And it works.
Quite a lot of Tennyson on that one, actually. Yeah.
So your final selection for us is For the Roses by Joni Mitchell.
Yeah, Joni Mitchell, yeah. I didn't have to, but when I thought about what songs I want, I thought, well, I want to put a Joni song in, because I only sort of really got into her relatively recently, over the last few years. And I don't like all of her stuff. I don't like the sort of later stuff when Jaco Pastorius starts playing bass and it all gets a bit jazzy. I really like the sort of Blue, For the Roses. Do you know these albums? Caught and Spark.
Yeah.
But I think For the Roses is my favourite album. It's not necessarily the best one, but there's moments when she's so, because she's so brilliant at capturing something lyrically.
I know.
And then the way that then works with her melodies is just quite ridiculously good at points. You just think, my God. And it's because she's not a trained musician. She's just like, she's just free to express herself, and she's not bound up in kind of, I don't know. You know what I mean? Sometimes it's good to not...
She was phenomenal.
Yeah.
And I remember seeing an interview with David Crosby, and one of his favourite
tricks... He said she was the best, didn't he?
He would like to get people into an altered state of consciousness, and then hit them with Joni playing in the room.
Right, yeah.
Watching their brains melt, So, what she could do with the voice and the guitar, and I think you're right, lyrically, she's...
But I mean, to be that sort of self-aware lyrically, anyway, we've been hurried up. So anyway,
so this
For the
is
Roses,
Roses,
Joni Mitchell.
Right on.
Sorry.
You're listening to Froome FM 96.6. This is Soundcheck with Sara Vian.
Dave Clark.
And we've got Craig Fortnum from Arch Garrison in the studio, live and direct.
Lovely.
Hello. So shall I play a song?
Joni Mitchell, so that was the last of your selections of influences, and you're going to give us another tune.
It's a kind of instrumental, this one. It's a sort of guitar piece. It has lots of keyboards on it normally. Yeah. I might hum a few of the keyboard parts.
Fine and dandy.
Is this from your first album?
Yes, it is, yeah. Just going to tune up a bit. Thank you. do another one there.
Shall I go straight?
Yeah, just crack on, yeah. All lovely. Right.
The bus, I'll take the underground. I like to beat the pavement round. Take a walk from East Cheek to the cricket ground. That's how the roots go down, down, stone on the pound. And she's there with me, she's my baby. Dog a run, a Martin down, clamber over ditch and mound. Let's poke about, see what's underground, and feel our roots go down, down, stone on the pound. And she's there with me, she's my baby.
Might have been a different one that I said I was going to play.
I think it might have been as well. What's that track called?
That's called Stone on the Pound.
Stone on the Pound.
Yeah, that's the one about living in the country but still feeling attached to London. So.
Yeah.
Yeah, so there's references to sort of.
Yeah. Yeah. And you want to use your feet rather than using the
wheels
to get about.
I really got a bit obsessed about the history of London. So I used to walk everywhere, you know. I didn't used to like get waiting for buses, always too impatient to wait for a bus, but I used to just like walking everywhere, you know, and cycling everywhere and getting to know the place. And
I remember that. I think if you choose not to use London the way they want you to use it, and you just use your bike or use
your
feet.
It's the best way, yeah.
You can.
It's not as big if you use a bike. No. You know, it shrinks a bit.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Excellent. Right, we're doing really well for time now, Sarah.
Mm.
Aren't we?
Yeah, we've got about
a quarter of
an hour.
I'm happy for you just to keep hitting us with tunes if you're up for it. You know, because we've got another 15
minutes.
Okay,
well, try to do a couple more or something and see how we do. And
that'd be lovely, yeah. If you're happy to do that, I'm happy to be entertained.
Okay, I'll do a song called Peekaboo.
Peekaboo, thank you.
Not the Devo, Peekaboo. It's nice to have something in common with Devo, though.
Thank you. so you're the one in form. You've been here before, and you look like no other. In a parallel universe, you're
So I'm reminded of Emiliana Torini, if that's the correct pronunciation. Do you remember her?
No, sorry.
Emiliana Torini, check her out.
Okay.
Emiliana Torini.
I've possibly got it totally wrong, but singer-songwriter with a very similar style.
Yeah.
But,
No, I'm hearing Robert Wyatt in the voice.
Right, yeah, maybe that has been said, yeah.
Yeah.
I wish.
The phrase was going through my head was the Johnny Marr of the nylon string guitar.
Johnny Marr of the nylon string guitar.
You know, because that finger picking that you do is so dexterous,
right?
And beautiful.
Dexterous extra. Dexterous extra. Breakfast,
it's
thing.
Dexterous is midnight runners.
Exactly. You could be. You
Shall
are.
I play another one then? What do you reckon?
I think so. Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't want to.
Yeah, we've got about 11 minutes.
We don't want to sweat yet. But you know, if you've got some more tunes,
shall I do one more?
But Peekaboo.
Yeah.
What was going on lyrically there?
It's a bit personal, really.
Oh, okay, fine.
Yeah, I'm not trying to completely bring everybody down.
I thought it was quite personal.
Yeah.
So we'll leave that for the...
Some things are best left.
We'll interpret it as we will.
Yeah.
Go on. Yeah, you can leave me with that. I'll figure it out myself.
Okay, I'll do one more. I'm not sure what to do. I'll do a song I wrote when... it's funny, when my son was born, I thought, I'm not going to write a song about it. You know, it's a bit...
Everyone does that.
And then, of course, you know, one came out, you know, I couldn't help it. Because it was so amazing, you know, to be a father. And so this song is about Sam. It's called Bubble, which was what his nickname was when he was a little baby.
All right, lovely.
if I can remember how to play it, because I haven't prepared this one. Bit of practice for next weekend, though,
yeah,
eh?
Good, okay.
Let's see if I'm in tune. Probably not.
To finish off with there, thanks.
Sorry, I was basically listing all the little body parts that I was amazed by when Sam was
the knee, under toe,
little toes and knees. Yeah. And things.
Yeah. Well, you know, it's a canon that it obviously was worth adding to, because that's beautiful, isn't it? That's on the new album, isn't it?
Yeah, that was on the because
he wasn't born for the first album. It's a gorgeous tune. What can I say? Yeah. Lovely, thank you. What we're going to talk about?
Well,
the fact is, you're doing a gig
next
in Froome.
Yeah,
we must reiterate. Sorry, Sarah.
Froome Festival.
It's part of the Froome Festival.
And gig at the Granary
on Saturday.
And the Granary is out the back of the George. If people are wondering,
if you're wondering where that is, because nobody ever sees it except at the festival.
There will be my good compadre James Larkin will be playing, adding lots of lovely organ and mono synth and things to the. gig, yes. Which is great. So because it's much more arranged, actually, these songs have all these bits in them going on, don't they? So
yeah.
There'll be some of that in there next week.
Ably supported by Dexter's Extra Breakfast as well.
We shall
so
be
it
there
be a good
doing
night.
Our bit in advance.
How much the tickets?
They're priced at £8, which I think is a very reasonable £4 per act.
And do people need to, or 6 and 2, do you reckon? I don't know.
Probably that.
Do people need to get them from the box office? Or?
Yeah, they're available through the festival box office at the Cheese and Grain.
Yeah, because...
Yeah.
Can you get them on the door there?
Or you could probably pay on the door.
Granary can be a bit funny, can't they?
They might stick an extra quid on it, but they'll have somebody there.
You better get your tickets now, guys, because...
I would say so.
You may not be able to get them on the door.
You don't want to miss this. It's going to be a musical treat.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, okay, so that's sorted out, isn't it?
That's that sorted out. So people should know now.
Yeah, sure.
Where it's happening next Saturday
night. And also... You know, give us your website address and all that jazz.
Well, what is it? Archgarrison.co.uk, I think. You know,
I bet
it's easy.
It
just Google it, don't you?
You're going to be talking. I suppose that's a completely different project, isn't it? The North Sea.
We're doing some gigs in September, yeah.
North Sea Radio Orchestra.
Yeah, but that'll be, I guess, actually more like October, November sort of time.
Yeah.
Okay.
Maybe try and do a Christmas show. We used to do Christmas gigs in these sort of churches in the city of London. They were really nice. It'd be nice to do one of those.
That'd be lovely. Yeah. Something I've wondered from time to time. Arch Garrison. Where did you get that name from?
Phil asked me to say it. I almost don't want to tell you because the answer is so boring and prosaic. It's like you wish you'd never asked. And I always think, right, seriously, there's not like a really great story behind it at all. In fact, the answer, you go, oh, like that. So I'm not going to tell you. Because I once tuned in to listen to a documentary talking about Jethro Tull about their album Aqualung. Yeah. Right, and in that documentary, I discovered why the album was called Aqualung. And the reason was kind of boring. And I thought, you know, I wish I'd never found that out. I wish I was none the wiser.
Yeah.
So you copied him in...
No, I just don't think
we're going to leave it. We're going to leave it shrouded in mystery then.
It's all just right, that, then. You know what I mean? If you sometimes telling people why things are, the reason is actually really boring and not very interesting, whereas in your imagination it might be much more interesting.
What I'm imagining is there was a bunch of people garrisoned at Marble Arch.
Oh, that's really weird. And that's exactly
there you
the
go.
Reason.
And your dad was serving... His National Service.
Very much like that.
Under the Marble Arch. Yeah.
So I've just got to tell the people, quickly about a special one-off show on Friday, July the 29th on FromeFM.
Oh, yeah.
Which is going to be live performances from some of Frome's young student bands and songwriters.
Oh, yeah.
A lineup to be confirmed will include Where the Water Lies, a four-piece band featuring solo Ray Candy on vocals and guitar, Jude Schofield on guitar, Sky Whitty on bass, and Mitchell Price on drums. And they write and compose most of their own songs with the odd cover thrown in. Influences are The Foles, Pearl Jam, and Alt J.
Interesting influences.
So that's great.
Pearl Jam, Alt J.
We're getting in touch with the local original youth.
The new youth
scene. They probably hate that word, actually.
The musical youth.
Yeah, the musical youth.
Past the Dutchie on the left-hand side. Was that?
That was that.
Yeah.
That was them.
And also just to say that the next Soundcheck show is going to be on July the 30th, and we're going to be having a band called Fabric, and you'll be hearing one of their tracks at the end of the show.
Are they from Bristol?
Radstock, I think. They'd probably preferred that they're from Bristol.
Everyone says Bristol if you know.
Yeah, probably. Sure they're from Bristol. Yeah.
Not Radstock
And I think that's all the information that we really need to give the people before
they don't need to know any more than they know now.
So everybody, just remember to get on down to the Granary next Saturday.
It is Saturday.
The 9th of July. To see Arch Garrison.
Yeah.
Performing live with Dexter's Extra Breakfast supporting them. That's going to be the event.
It's going to be
super in Frome next Saturday.
It's going to be beautiful.
Yep.
Yeah.
And thanks so much for coming into the studio.
Thanks for having me, guys.
Yeah. Cheers, Craig.
It's been
lovely.
A pleasure.
Yeah.
So are we ready to say goodbye to everyone? And
let's play out with a bit of Fabric.
Bit of Fabric.
Yeah.
Here we go.